So yeah, let's now talk about the receiver operating characteristic or receiver operator characteristic curve. So what is the receiver operating characteristic curve? It's kind of a tongue twister almost. So the ROC curve, the term comes from the context of radar receiver operators, like observing radars, like the radio direction and ranging technology. So it was used in that context, but why is it so popular in machine learning? So it's because it combines both the true positive rate and the false positive rate. So it's looking at both of those. And how it is plotted is by changing the prediction threshold. So here's an example. I will show you or explain to you what I mean by changing the prediction threshold in a moment. So, but yeah, here's a receiver operating characteristic curve where you have the true positives on the y-axis and the false positive rate on the x-axis. And so what I mean by changing the threshold is if you have a binary classification problem, so you have class 0 and class 1, you can have a class membership probability. This is quite natural for something like logistic regression, but it can also be created for other types of classifiers, for example, k-nearest neighbors and decision trees and so forth. So in a k-nearest neighbor example, so the class membership probability could be the ratio of one class over the other in the neighborhood. So if you have, for example, we had this example, I think, in the context of k-nearest neighbors, but just as a recap, if we have something like this, and my neighborhood, my five nearest neighbors are those, then let's say the triangle is class 0, and the dot is class 1, then for the triangle, here I would have a 3 over 5, so this would be a 3 over 5, and for class 0, this would be a 2 over 5 for one training example, and then I can fill out this list. So usually, so we have like these probabilities, but we could actually shift the probability, the threshold. We say, so if we have the equal number, let's take a case of two triangles and two circles, then we have a 2 over 4, and 2 over 4 would be our boundary where we are uncertain. If it's over the boundary, like 3 out of 4, then we say class 0, and if it's 1 out of 4, we say class 1, the other way around, or the other way around. So 2 out of 4.5 is our threshold here. So in a case of logistic regression, 0.5 is also the threshold where we decide between class 0 and class 1, where we are uncertain. If it's slightly above 0.5, we say class 1, below 0.5, class 0. And usually we also have a tiebreaker, right? So usually we use the lower class as the tiebreaker, so in this case class 0. But we can actually shift this threshold because it can be arbitrary depending on whether we want to optimize for the true positive rate or the false positive rate. It can be kind of arbitrary where we set the threshold. So the receiver operator characteristic curve is measuring how the performance of the classifier behaves in terms of true positive rates and false positive rates if we change the threshold. So instead of using a 0.5 threshold, for example, what happens if we use a 0.4 threshold or 0.3 threshold and so forth. So each jump here in the line is for a different threshold, basically. So it could be, for example, the 0.3 threshold, the 0.4 threshold, the 0.5 threshold, 0.6, and so forth. So this is like showing you how sensitive the classifier is to setting the threshold. So in terms of the accuracy, we don't have a threshold. We use one particular threshold. For this receiver operator characteristic curve, we change this threshold that we use for determining whether it's a class 0 and a class 1. So if, for example, if we have a high threshold, like 0.9, we require, let's say, 4 out of the 5 to be of the same class in order to predict class 1 and otherwise class 0, and or the other way around. So in that way, we influence how sensitive the class assignment is with these changing thresholds. And now let me try to explain this in the context of a figure that I showed you earlier. So earlier I showed you this figure and said that on the x-axis that's a particular feature and we shift the decision boundary. However, this was just a workaround to make the explanation a little bit easier. Here on the x-axis what we have is the class membership probability. So for example, if 0.5 is our decision threshold, then if you think back of the previous slide where I showed you the k and n, we had a 3 out of 5 or a 2 out of 5, whether it's above or below this 0.5 decision threshold. Here, I mean, in the k nearest neighbor case, it's not like a smooth transition because we have these jumps, because we have a particular number of neighbors. If it's 2 or 3 out of 5, we don't have like 2.5 out of 5. However, for other models, it can be smoother. For example, in the case of logistic regression, which we haven't covered in this class, but in any case, so here, what that figure shows is what happens if we change this threshold, how we influence the number of false positives and true positives. So if we change this threshold, if we say everything, let's say, by above 0.4 is class 1, then we increase the number, or we can increase the number of true positives, but that it, then it would also increase the number of false positives and so forth, as I explained earlier. So changing the decision threshold will have an effect on both the false positives and the true positives. And the receiver operator characteristic curve shows you how. So it shows you for different thresholds how it would look like. For example, we can optimize the threshold such that we have a high true positive rate. For example, compare this point to this point, but at the same time we may be increasing the false positive rate as well. In a practical application, we would pick one point for the classifier. So depends on what you care more about, the true positive rate or the false positive rate. For example, in the email classification example, in the spam classification example, we would probably picking a threshold that is more on the lower end where we have a low false positive rate, even though the true positive rate is not as high. So this is something that is very application specific, where it would be advised to talk to a domain expert for whom you are solving a problem using machine learning, if you have a machine learning application, and then design a threshold that meets the criteria. So what I'm actually trying to get here is in the slide is how would a perfect classifier look like and how would a random classifier look like. So if we would have a classifier that would predict class labels randomly in a balanced class, just in general, it doesn't have to be balanced, how would a random prediction look like? And so how would a perfect classifier look like in terms of the curve? So maybe pause this video at this moment and think about it a little bit, and then I will show you how it would look like. Okay, if you thought about it a little bit, so the random guessing, this would actually be a diagonal here. So a random classifier that randomly predicts zeros or ones and doesn't really learn anything from the data, it would be a diagonal. And a perfect classifier, it would have a very high true positive rate. It predicts all the cases correctly while never predicting a false positive. So a perfect classifier would look like this, and a random classifier would look like this. So then you know, okay, this is actually here somewhat in the middle. So usually in practice it's hard, if you have multiple machine learning models, to find out which one performs better than the other by just looking at these curves, especially if these curves intersect. So in that way it's also very common to compute the area under the curve. So by the area under the curve I mean everything here below this curve. You would integrate that and compute the area. So in this case it would be 0.8. so a perfect classifier would have 1.0 and a random classifier would have 0.5. so just to illustrate why the random case is a diagonal, so here, just for reference, how we compute the true positive rate again and the false positive rate, like we discussed in the confusion matrix video, where we have the true positives, false negatives, false positives, and true negatives. And now consider a case where we have a balanced data set. So we have a balanced data set and we make predictions randomly. So it randomly predicts, so every class is equally likely. So in this case, if we compute the true positive rate, the true positive rate is computed as the number of true positives divided by the total number of positives. So let's fill in these numbers here. So we have 100, 100, 100, 100. Now let's take a look at the true positives. This is this number here. So we have a 100 here. And the number of positives, this is this number here. So we have 200. So 100 over 200 is 0.5, right? So in this way, the true positive rate is 0.5. And then for the false positive rate, how we compute that is the number of false positives divided by the negatives. So the number of false positives is, let me use a different color, is the 100 here divided by all the negatives, which is 200. So again, we get a 0.5. So this is for this one here, we get a 0.5. If we have a random prediction. So, and then if we would shift the classifier left and right, we would shift it along this diagonal, basically. So if we would shift the threshold. So for the imbalanced case, it's also, again, the same. It starts at this 0.5 here and goes left and right. So why is this 0.5 again? So we can compute the number again. So if we have 200 and 200 for the positives, so this row, let me use a different color. So these are the positives, and then this is the true positives. So we have 200 divided by 400, and then again so we have fewer negatives now. So we have only 100 negatives, but again, then we also have fewer false positives. So again, it's 0.5, and then if you slide the threshold, usually it also slides along this line here. Okay, so yeah, this is how it would look like for a random classifier, and this is like some intuition behind it. And how about now combining receiver operator characteristic curves and, let's say, K-fold cross-validation? This is in practice also not a big deal, so you could actually make a ROC curve for each fold. So you can make for a three-fold cross-validation case, in this case, three ROC curves, and then you can average over the ROC curves, and the same thing is also true then for the area under the curve, which is what I've done here. So in black, this is the average area under the curve for K-fold cross-validation. How do we do that in Python, scikit-learn? So here I'm using two functions. So I'm using the ROC curve function and the AUC function. The AUC is for computing the area under the curve, and the ROC curve is for computing the ROC curve. There is also ROC AUC function, as far as I know, which does both in once. So you can actually use the ROC underscore AUC function to do or achieve both in one step. So here I'm using our data set from before, the Wisconsin breast cancer data set, but in order to make it a little bit more challenging, I'm only using two features, feature 5 and feature 15, because otherwise it would be a little bit too easy for the classifier, because then the ROC curves won't look very interesting. It would be too easy to classify those. So I just picked a subset of the features to have some more noise, more challenge. I'm creating basically a more challenging problem here, just for visualization purposes. So I'm plotting both the ROC curve for the training and testing separately using a k-nearest neighbor classifier here. And so here, this is for training. So I'm fitting it first, and then I'm returning the probabilities. So this is, like I explained before, it's like the ratio of the neighbors, so the majority of the neighbors from a particular class. So I'm getting now these probabilities, which I am then using here in my ROC curve function. So here I'm giving it the class 1 labeled. So you have, usually if you have a binary classification problem, you have two columns, class 1 class 0. You have two columns returned from this predict proba function. If you have two classes, if you have three classes, it will be three columns. So it will give you the class membership probability for each class. And then I'm only selecting the one for class 1. So this column here, I will select this one. And also tell the RCCore function that I'm setting this as the positive label. And this will then give me my false positive rates and true positive rates together with the decision thresholds. You can take a look at them maybe later. So, and then to compute the area under the curve, you can apply the AUC function, the area, I should maybe spell that out, area under the curve. Oops. So you can get the area under the curve by applying this function to the false positives and true positive rates. And I'm plotting this here as a step function. So this is how it looks like. And I'm, by the way, doing the same thing for the test set here. So the only difference to what I've shown you in the previous slide is that I'm now using the test set. And so you can see this classifier suffers from overfitting quite a lot. So in blue, that's the training ROC, and in orange, that's the test AUC. And you can see the test AUC is still better than random guessing. It's 0.7, but it's not great. So the training one is higher, and there's quite a gap. So it's a lot of overfitting going on here. All right, so this is how it would look like for our breast cancer data set. And here is another example for Kfold cross-validation. So for Kfold cross-validation, what I'm doing is I'm using the stratified Kfold class here, and I'm creating this cross-validation iterator. So, and then, I'm iterating through my cross-validation iterator. So I'm using it as a list here. I'm already applying the split function, but you could technically initialize the Kfold cross-validation iterator and then call split here, but here it's just a little bit simpler, because then I could just squish everything into one slide here, so that it's not too much code in one slide, too many lines of code. And then I'm computing the ROC curve for each Kfold cross-validation step, and then averaging over those and so forth. So I have the code notebook here on GitHub, so if you want to reproduce it. And also, just in practice, if you want to use the ROC function, I don't think I have it here, but if you want to use the ROC function, for example, in grid search, there is also ROC AUC in scikit-learn. So here I'm using ROC curve and AUC separately as two separate functions, but there's also one function that does both in one step. And I believe this is in chapter 6 in the Python machine learning book. I'm pretty sure I used that there. So you can also use that one for reference. Okay, so then we are approaching the last topic for this week already. It's extending binary metrics to multi-class settings. So I don't think we can cover feature selection, which would be probably also 1 or 2 hour lecture. And I don't want to overburden you with too many materials this week, because you are working on your class projects and also the homework is due. So let's make this our last video.